It seems to be a crime to be want to have a job that you can pay for your house, pay for your rent, have kids, have a family, and have money left over at the end of the day. Why is that a problem?
The trade union movement was never founded for dollars and cents. The trade union movement was founded, bear with me, the trade union movement was founded so workers could go to work with a degree of dignity. And that's what I would tell them. And there's a chance now to retain and reacquire some of that dignity because they've kicked the shit out of us.
And instead of corporations trying to bring the standards in employment down, we need to push to put it up.
The future prosperity of working people are tied, in my mind, to the future of unions. And we need to help people realize and educate them that an attack on unions is an attack on you as a member of the working class, whether you're a union member or not.
And there's definitely a resurge in the popularity of the Confederation of Canadian Unions today. The need is great.
Running the business of the union takes up a lot of our time, and it's nice to have a labor central like the CCU.
The good news is the Confederation of Canadian Unions has never been more relevant. Fundamental principles of the Confederation of Canadian Unions is to maintain, for locals to maintain their autonomy and their independence, while also sharing and having a forum as a labor central, and that's what the CCU offers. So smaller independent unions have had to come forward and have a voice, and the Confederation of Canadian Unions helps bridge those voices together and provides a platform that otherwise these smaller independent unions might not have.
We want to talk to them and describe to them how we do our business, how representation and how democracy and how local autonomy works within the PPWC ranks, and how it's different from their current union, because we are so different than the business type unions in the rest of Canada.
Through the CCU, we do a lot of the defense of workers' rights, both in Canada and globally.
And certainly within the affiliates, whether we're talking about the Nova Scotia Union of Public and Private Employees, through to the York University Staff Association, CO2, we all have opportunities for growth and expansion, because there's so many independent unions out there that have not attached themselves to a larger labor central. They haven't found their home, so to speak. So as we become more and more aware of these locals, or locals in turn become more and more aware of the Confederation of Canadian Unions, we have nothing but opportunities for growth.
What I do see is different people come and go, and you know, people have different ideas. You know, certainly labor laws have changed and we've had to adapt, but the idea that we're a union that has local autonomy, that gives each local the opportunity to control their own destiny.
To see the benefits from a unionized workplace, especially when you're working for us, we're dealing with the government, you know, why we need it in our place. I find it a necessity to have somebody to speak up when there's concerns raised. If you're not, you feel like you're not being heard, and you have someone to go to, it makes a difference, you know, rather than falling on deaf ears.
One of the great challenges that we have to face is to engage young workers. We have to look at the fact that once labor history was removed from the high school curriculum, we have a generation of people who assume, they make assumptions about benefits, they make assumptions about living standards, and only because there has been no labor education. And that's part of our role, in order to engage young workers to appreciate the benefits of organized labor, is to launch a media campaign and an education campaign that in some way will engage them.
I think it's important for young workers to learn their rights, learn the labor code, Talk to local union representatives. Even if you and your job aren't represented by a local, unions are always willing to talk to people. I mean, you may not necessarily be in a situation where you can organize, but organizing is an option. We're always willing to talk to people about your rights.
You know, we have forestry seminar, environmental seminar. So the opportunity is there for anybody who's new to the union movement to find out exactly about the work that we have done and the work that we are doing.
It's been my experience that there is no adequate voice for labor that exists outside the CCU. It seems patently unfair to assume that Canadian workers would be represented by international interests headquartered in Washington, D.C. or somewhere else.
Getting a huge corporate structure in the trade union movement is just an imitation of that, and you become part of that bloody problem.
It's not, that doesn't happen in the CCU. You have a voice. You have a clear voice. At the table, you're there. You have a vote.
It's so necessary to have an alternative, in my opinion. And I've come to that conclusion. I'm going to be 73 on April 8th.
There's probably very, very few unions that operate the way we do and allow for that local autonomy. So, I just don't think you can say enough about the ability of our union to allow people to control their own destiny. And that's hugely important. That's what people want out of life.
When I took part in more union activities, I would not call myself a capital U union member. I just wanted to make a difference.
I see my vision of the CCU is that they're going to grow into a more national voice for the independent Canadian unions.
As the former president of the Confederation of Canadian Unions, I'm just really excited to see and observe what the CCU does and how it expands over the next 5 to 10 years. I think it's going to be a really exciting time to watch.
The strength of the labor movement in its time of greatest growth and strength was that it said, we are fighting for the dignity of labor, we are fighting for the value of our work, we are fighting for a society where those things matter.
And I think we all have to stand up for each other around the world to make sure that ILO conventions are upheld and that workers' rights and human rights are upheld on a global scale, because it's a global economy now.
From that basis, what sort of society would it take to create an institution like that? What we are, as a group of people living together, as 35 million Canadians who are actually providing the necessities of life to one another. We would need to reimagine work so that workers don't have to go to their job 40 hours a week and have no time to read, to study, to enjoy their life. We would need to reduce the amount of time that workers have to spend on the job. We would need to reimagine society much more broadly. We need to imagine a transition from this sort of unregulated free market capitalism that we have today to something very different, to some form of socialism that actually provided the needs and put the needs of citizens, workers, students above the needs of corporate greed.
And once people can look at and see what would be in it for them and what's in it for them not to support organized labor and what we're trying to achieve across the country, that's when you see those lights go on and you see that little flicker in the eye and you know that you've touched a nerve, that makes it all worthwhile to me. And I think that when you see it, you know it, and when you know it, you feel it, and when you feel it, you get inspired to continue and to work even harder.